Now, children, continuing with your poem, an elementary school classroom in a slum, let me start with a paraphrasing of the poem. Now, before I start with the paraphrasing, let me tell you there are many difficult words, so you need to jot down the meanings of the words. I'll also send you the word meanings in a word file where you'll get the meanings of the difficult words, and you need to write down what all explanation I'm giving it to you so that the paraphrasing is clear to you, right? Now, let me start from the first stanza. Far from gusty ways, these children faces, like rootless weeds, the hair torn round their pallor, the tall girl with her weighed down head, the paper seeming boy with rat's eyes. I'm repeating. Far from gusty ways, these children's faces, like rootless weeds, the hair torn round their pallor, the tall girl with a weighed down head, the paper seeming boy with rat's eyes. Now, before I give you the explanation, let me give you the meanings of the difficult words here. Gusty waves here refers to breezy winds. Pallor is pale or dull face. Then here is a word that is stunted with rat's eyes. I have done till rat's eyes. So we are having stunted here. Yes. Far from gusty waves, these children faces like rootless weeds, a hair torn round their pallor. The tall girl with her weighed down head, the paper seeming boy with rat's eyes. Okay. So let me continue with the paraphrasing. I'm repeating these lines again. Far, far from gusty waves, these children faces like rootless weeds, the hair torn round their pallor, the tall girl with her weighed down head. Weight is heavy weight. Weighed down head. The paper seeming boy with rat's eyes, the stunted unlucky hair, twisted bones, the stunted unlucky hair of twisted bones, reciting a father's gnarled disease, his lesson from his desk at back of the dim class, one unknotted, sweet and young. His eyes live in a dream of squirrel's game in tree room other than this. Now let me give you the meanings of the difficult word first of all. Gusty waves here refer to breezy winds. Pallor is pale, dull face. Stunted, something which is not a person or a child who is not fully grown due to malnutrition because he suffered, he was not having proper nutrition. So gnarled is knotted roughly. Hair gnarled here refers to father's gnarled disease, knotted rough. Reciting a father's gnarled disease, knotted rough. Weeds, we know that is unwanted plants that grow in between. So paper seeming boy, the boy who is very slim, very thin, as a thin sheet of paper. Now, let me give you the description of this first stanza. The poet describes the children. The poet describes the children who study in an elementary school. The poet describes the children who study in an elementary school which is set up in a slum area. He says that the faces of the children are dull, without any energy. These children are very dull. They are not having any energy. Pallor, I told you, means dull, pale-faced. So these children are not having any energy. They are not full of energy like other kids of their age. These children are also compared to unwanted weed. Weed, I told you, is unwanted plants which grow in between the plants. So, which is a figure of speech used here, that also you need to notice, like rootless weed. So, kindly write down, it is simile used here, where direct comparison is there by the using the word like. So, the children are compared to unwanted weed. Here the writer wants to say that these children seem to be unwanted like the unwanted weeds which grow on their own in the fields. Their hair is not neatly done. It falls on their pale faces as if they have been torn apart. They are not properly dressed up. Their hair are not made. So it gives a peel as if they are torn apart. The children are untidy. They haven't combed their hair. Then he describes a tall girl. Then a tall girl is also described here, who seems to be burdened by poverty. Here these lines that, oh, weighed, her head weighed down. Because of poverty, her head is down. She is burdened by the burden of poverty. Her head is bent, maybe because of tiredness or shame. Maybe because she is shameful the way she has dressed up, or maybe she is too tired because of the burden of the poverty, because of her responsibilities. Her head is bent down. Her head is bent, maybe because of tiredness or shame. There is another boy who is so weak and thin that he has been compared to a sheet of paper. I told you the boy is compared to a sheet of paper because the boy is very thin. The boy's eyes reflect greed and he wants to achieve everything. The tall girl with a weighed down head because of poverty. The tall girl is putting her head down. Maybe she is feeling a lot of shame. And she's burdened by the burden of poverty. And the paper seeming boy. The boy is seeming like a paper. He's so thin. He seems like a paper. And at the same time, who is weak. This boy has been compared to a sheet of paper. His eyes reflect greed. And he wants to achieve everything. People, at times you will find that people who do not even get the basics of life, they have that greed to achieve something major, something big in life, because they actually understand what they don't have. Then he describes another student who is physically disabled. Now, the next lines describe another student who is physically disabled. The poet says that this boy is unlucky because he inherited a disease from his father, due to which he has a deformed body. There are certain diseases which come from their parents, right? So this boy is deformed because he is hiring. The word H-E-I-R, hire. He's hiring that disease from his father. So this poor boy is deformed, right? So the poet says that this boy is unlucky because he inherited a disease from his father, due to which he has a deformed body. Instead of getting any facility from his father, he has received this disease as in heritage. So rather than getting any asset or any property, any money or any comforts from his father, this poor child has got this disease from his father in heritage. This disabled boy is sitting on his bench and is reciting his lesson. So this poor boy is sitting on the desk and he is reciting a lesson. He's trying to learn something from the book. At the back of the class, in a dim dark area, was a small boy who was not visible to the poet as he was sitting in darkness. Now there is another boy sitting in darkness who is not visible because he is sitting at the last bench where there is complete dark, so the poet cannot see him. The poet could see his eyes, which were bright and full of dream. The poet could only see his twinkling eyes because his eyes were full of dreams and they were twinkling. He was not paying attention to the class. It seemed as if he was rather interested in playing with squirrels in the tree house, because this boy was not interested in paying attention to what was going in the class. He was more interested in the tree, the squirrels who were jumping on the tree or in the tree house. So the first stanza basically tells us about the environment of this elementary school classroom. The poet says that the classroom describes the children who study here. Their faces are dull, without any energy. Then he talks about a girl who is. He talks about a boy first of all. He says that these children are like unwanted weeds. They have grown on their own. Their hair is not properly done. They are untidily dressed up and they haven't combed their hair. Then he describes a tall girl who seems to be burdened by poverty, whose head is weighed down by poverty because of shame or because of the burden of poverty. She is not looking up also. And then he talks about the boy who wants to achieve everything. His eyes is shining. Then he talks about another student who is physically disabled. He's deformed because he has got this thing from his father, inheritance. He's not got any asset or property from his father. Rather, he has got this disease from his father. And then he also talks about a little boy who sits at the back, whose face is not visible because he's sitting in dark. Only his eyes are visible as he is looking at the squirrels jumping on the tree.